Alex has a question here. How can I tell the difference between a plant element that is advancing a succession when I chop and drop, and a plant that is one of the problems I need to try and get ahead of? Well, there's different ways of looking at this, and I'm gonna have to give you two different examples. Here I have a giant bamboo planted on the side of a ridge track, and it's definitely allelopathic. In other words, nothing much likes to grow in the drip zone where the hair roots come out and you get all this high silica mulch. So it's not favoring the ground around it for other plants. And that can be an advantage if you want a clear area with no weed growth. Or not much that's going to grow once this is established. If it's established before, it might keep going for a while, but if it once this large bamboo or any bamboo around it, you won't get much establishing coming in of anything much. But this material is high in silica and it will break down. So I can chop this, I can chop it up, and I can use it for mulch somewhere else where I'm not getting a root net effect. So what I'm saying is some things are not necessarily good for the area they're in, but that doesn't mean their mulch can't be moved and be valuable on the ground or as a breakdown addition to the soils. Now, bamboos and canes are very useful in the subtropics to tropics as an addition to soils where silicas can be depleted. So not good where it is, but growing other things near it, you get a nice cleared, clean area under it that you can design nice around the shoreline of a dam, makes a kind of bamboo leaf fall beach kind of thing. Clear of any weeds or easily clear the weeds, they won't re-establish. But this material moved out can be used as a mulch that will allow other things to grow. But what we need to do is go and have a look at an allelopathic element that is bad even as mulch until the fungi have got hold of it and broken its allelopathy. So here we have another element that's allelopathic. This is camphor laurel. It's a large tree. And not much likes to grow underneath a camphor laurel. They'll kind of dominate the landscape. And they've been introduced to Australia and shared with all the schools in New South Wales and Queensland as a shade tree, and nothing grows underneath. That looked like a good idea for the children, creating clear ground. But it was allelopathy that created that cleared ground. They are a big glossy shade tree, but the local Australian pigeon eats the berries and flies off and manures it out, and it drops out in the subtropical zones of southeast Queensland and northern New South Wales and other places, other cooler subtropical areas of the world. You'll find camphor laurel propagated by forest pigeons, and they pop the seed out and it germinates, and cattle don't eat it. So they tend to, they will trample on it and stop it growing by accident, but it comes up on fence lines where they don't walk on it, and you get camphor laurel dominance coming in. And when you walk away or don't maintain it, it takes over and dominates the forest. It's a strong camphor smell. It was used for making camphor wood chests, and also a natural penetrating massage oil. One of the deepest, fastest penetrating massage oils was made with camphor oil, but all of that's old-fashioned stuff. Now it's pretty rare that there are any factories. Taiwan, there might be a factory or two left where there was a big camphor laurel industry for camphor oil and camphor wood. It's a timber that only works inside. Outside it rots, but it has a strong allelopathy around when it's growing. But if you use this as mulch, it affects the seedlings, and you can see straight away that your vegetable seeds won't grow very well. If you add this to your compost, it slows down the compost action. If you add this in your compost toilet, the composted humanure with this as an addition of camphor sawdust, let's say, it slows down the germination of other elements around it. It's a definite growth retardant. Its life cycle here is about 120 years, and then the center dies out and the tree starts to rot from the middle, and then all of a sudden a massive amount of rainforest germination comes up under the camphor as it rots down. Because at that point, when it starts to break down and the fungus start to eat the tree, the allelopathy is broken. And there seems to be a massive dormancy of pigeon import of rainforest seeds. So there's a seed bank delivered by the pigeons of high quality rainforest trees that don't germinate until the allelopathy is broken. So what you can actually do with this sort of thing is you can actually cut it, cut branches, cut mulch, chop it up or chip it, make a big pile of it, keep it damp until you get ear fungus on the outside. When you get ear fungus on the material as it breaks down, the fungus has got hold of the pile, the allelopathy is broken, then you can use it. So it's a strategic process where you partner with the actions of fungi to break the allelopathy, and you'll find that with all those allelopathic elements. And this is a massive one. Although it dominates, in the end, after 120 years, it allows a massive recruitment of rainforest. So if we're patient enough, we don't have a demand for use of the land, it's actually a long-term pioneer, although it has this allelopathic phase. So you'll find that with all of those types of elements. Just keep your eyes open, just see what happens. If you've got a lot of it, you can break the allelopathy with fungi, or you can just wait until the element goes through its successional cycle. But what will happen is it will burst then into high quality regrowth. And if that's what you want, that's fine. High quality regeneration of local with some novel components. If you want to break it quickly and put the land into use, then there are ways we can do it.